Tarzan of the Apes, brought to you from out the pages of Edgar Rice Burroughs' adventurous book. James calls for help, and the shattering crash of the revolver shot carries a Tarzan and Clayton standing face to face in the jungle.
James, never!
Tarzan seizes Clayton and swings him to his shoulders. Clayton struggles futilely and then stops. Surely this man who has rescued him from the leopard can mean him no harm. Tarzan springs into the lower branches of a great tree. He grips a trailing vine and, in spite of his double burden, swings into the lower terrace of the forest. Up, up he goes into the bending, swaying branches of the higher terrace. His sure eye and practiced hands carry them with incredible speed through the maze of interwoven vines and branches. Faster and faster they speed toward the hut. Now the foliage is less dense. Tarzan's penetrating gaze sees Sabor, crouched, ready to hurl her bulk at the frail latticed window of the hut. She screams! The light bars give under her hurtling weight. Tarzan knows the lattice will not withstand many such shocks. He leaps into space, grips a sturdy vine, a dizzy, flashing arc. He lets go, grips the lower branch. It bends. Again, he lets go. Down, down he drops. He disappears into a deep well of tree fern and bamboo. Spinning, swinging downward from branch to vine, he plunges toward the jungle floor. Tarzan's feet touch the ground. Clayton slides from his back. Together they race toward the hut, clearing the intervening ground with lightning speed. Sabor leaps. The last bar snaps. The great yellow head and four paws are inside the hut. Tarzan covers the last few feet with a flying leap. He seizes Sabor by the tail. Twist. Flings his body back. Feet braced against the hut. Pulls with all his mighty strength. Clayton grabs the man and trying to help. The Rangali of Noodles. Tarzan shouts to Clayton and plunges a poisoned arrow into Sabor. The Englishman tries to understand the ape man's orders. Sabor's clawing, fighting to force her way into the window. With a snarl of rage, she lets go her clutch on the sill, the twist, and pounces upon the enemy behind her. Tarzan lets go. With the speed of a striking cobra, he launches himself full on the infuriated beast's back. Like lightning, his arm encircles the brute's neck. He digs his feet into Sabor's loins. Tarzan's biceps swell. Back, back. Inch by inch, she pulls the tawny, twisting head. Sabor throws herself on her side, thrashing, tearing. Her working claws barely miss Clayton as he leaps aside. Porter and Philander break through the brush border in the jungle. One glance through the doors and sprinkles with Sabor, and they start to run toward them. Sabor twists her head. The snapping, falling jaws tight against the arm of steely muscle about her throat. Tarzan tries to get his knife. Sabor springs to her feet. She leaps into the air. Harder and harder, Tarzan pulls the slashing head. Now he has his knife. Back, back, he forces Sabor's straining neck. The knife flashes up. Down! Again and again, the gleaming blade rises and falls, plunges deep into Sabor's unprotected side. Slowly, the lioness crumples to the ground. Tarzan leaps aside, sets his foot on Sabor's neck, raises his face to the skies. The victory cry of the bull ape that has made his kill echoes and re-echoes through the jungle. Tarzan glances once at Clayton, reaches for a low-hanging branch, and swings himself into the tree.
Jane! Are you hurt?
No, I'm all right. Just a second. One at a time, please.
Oh, I heard a shot. I boxed up and returned. And when I went to the door, there was a lion. I slammed the door. Then came a terrible scratching. Then it stopped. For the moment, I thought it had gone away. The next thing I knew, its terrible yellow eyes were glaring at me from the window. Oh, for hours, it seemed as though I couldn't move. Then I remembered the revolver. I shot him.
Yes, Jane. We heard the shot. Knew it came from the hut and... Well, you know the rest.
The most amazing exhibition I have ever witnessed. Philander and I arrived precisely at the moment when the pagan person leapt upon the back of the lion. Such strength, such astounding agility.
He saved me only a few moments before we heard Jane's shot. I was attacked by a leopard, but just as the beast was about to spring...
Don't you think that he's Tarzan of the Apes?
Tarzan of the Apes? Oh, no. No, I don't believe he can be. Cecil spoke to him, but he doesn't speak English. Tarzan can read and write English, we know, because of the warning he sent to the door of the hut. But, Cecil, this man did speak to you in some strange tongue.
Ah, you say he spoke to Cecil?
Yes. He shouted something to me while he was fighting with the lion.
Exactly. It proves beyond the shadow of a doubt that he, as I have never doubted, has had contact with other humans. Now, Clayton, What sort of sounds did she shout to you?
Well, it... Oh, by Jove, I'm dashed if I can remember.
Did he make any such sound as laugh? Or perhaps laugh?
No. No, I remember no such sound. Why?
Sir Richard Paget has worked out 320 primitive roots from which all Aryan language is derived. The sound, thus, laugh, laugh, the dropping of the tongue and pressing of the tongue against the teeth, signifies laugh, to lift. I thought, perhaps, if he lifted you or wished to lift something, he might have said laugh.
No, I'm sure there was no such sound. He did shout something, as near as I can recall, which sounded like cow or bund.
There was no L sound? You're quite sure?
Of course, Professor, in the excitement, I could not really qualify as a scientific observer.
No, of course not, sir. Of course not. Still, I wish you had been able to retain some definite syllabic context. Perhaps a lush sound.
Well, still, Daddy, it's evident the man has some sort of rational language, even if he could not convey his thought to Cecil.
No doubt of it, Jane, no doubt of it. The mere fact that Clayton recognized the shout as some attempt to convey information or direction...
My thought, exactly. Then the fact would show that the man is social, tribal.
Well, it's getting frightfully cold out here. Let's go inside the hut. And Cecil...
Yes, Jane?
I think before any of us tries to sleep here, after the experience we've just had, we ought to get some sort of that window barred in some sort of way that will prevent anything like this happening again.
I thoroughly agree. And tonight it will be fixed.
Well, thank you, Cecil.
Come, give me a hand, Professor. Let's move this carcass away from the hut.
Yes, perhaps we might as well. Bless me. We two cannot even budge it. Yet the man who killed it held it with one arm. Astounding.
Don't bother moving that. It'll be gone in the morning. The jackals, you know.
Why, yes, of course. How silly of me.
That Philander, it was unnatural. If I may be permitted the expression, a most natural thought.
Yeah, of course. I realize that Jane has been through a harrowing experience and so on, but do you suppose perhaps we might, are we to have dinner?
Really, Philander, that is quite a good suggestion. Now that you've broached the subject, you know, I feel that I myself could do with something to fortify the inner man.
I really hate to say anything to Jane.
However, it will take her mind off the excitement. Yes, I feel we should soothe her in some manner domestic.
Then, with your approval, Professor, let us enter the hut.
Very well. Jane! Jane, my dear!
Daddy!
Jane, my love... Could you prepare a light collation? In other words, something to eat?
The light from the cabin streams across the clearing, cutting the jungle into strips of black and silver. Animal trails, mere breaks in the brush by day, now loom like yawning caverns in their inky blackness. From afar off, the harsh, rasping laugh of a hyena tells that the scavenger of the jungle has found some undevoured kill. One by one, the stars pierce the sable sky. The young moon, slender as a silver thread, glints through the sparse tops of the alders. Sleepy monkeys open and close their eyes as Tarzan leisurely brushes his way through the branches toward the hut. Just as the ape, which for sheer joy of living swings by the hour from branch to branch, so Tarzan, fed and rested, drops to the light-flooded clearing at the hut. Cautiously, he approaches the window, looks inside. With quickened pulse, entranced, he watches the white she he had rescued earlier in the day, seated at the table, his table. He longs to speak to her, but dares not, convinced that, like the men, she will not understand him. Jane Porter finishes the letter she's been writing to her friend, rises, and puts out the light. Patiently, Tarzan waits until his keen ears tell him that all movement within the hut has ceased for the night. Cautiously, he moves closer to the window. He hears the deep, regular breathing which denotes sleep. Slowly, carefully, he passes his hand through the broken lattice, takes the letter from the table. Quietly, he moves back, folds the paper, places it in his quiver with his arrows, and melts into the jungle shadows while the hyena creeps forward to the dead body of Satan.